Is the continuous integration pipeline slow? I think every developer deserves a fast pipeline, because a slow pipeline not only increases frustration, but also affects your productivity. So in this video, I'm going to show you 8 tips on how to make your pipeline run in seconds instead of minutes. As with any optimization task, we need to start by measuring and creating a baseline. So open whatever analytics you have in your CI platform and see how your pipeline is doing. At the minimum, we want to measure the average pipeline duration, the average duration of your jobs, and the failure rate for your pipeline. The quickest way to improve the speed is using a more powerful machine. This is what we call vertical scaling. We upgrade the machine running our pipeline with one with more CPU, with more memory, maybe with a GPU. On cloud platforms, it can be as easy as provisioning a more powerful machine and running our jobs there. The other way to increase the compute power of our pipeline is with horizontal scaling. This is called parallelization, and the essence of this is that we split our tests, our jobs, across multiple machines. So what kind of jobs can we parallelize? The best candidates are anything that doesn't produce an artifact. For example, tests, which are simply passing or failing, static analysis tools like linters or code formatters, security analysis tools that will tell us if there is any problems with our dependencies. Everything that doesn't produce side effects are things like accessing an API, a database, a disk, or producing an artifact. Everything that doesn't have side effects is a good candidate for parallelization. So if our pipeline is going to fail, it's better to fail fast. Putting our fast test first is going, on average, to reduce our times when we have multiple failures. So we don't need to run the whole pipeline. Anytime one service is changed, we only run the test associated to that test. We can also choose to skip some tests. If we design the code in a modular way, we can choose to skip tests. When we have tests associated to each module in our codebase, and that codebase hasn't changed, we can skip this test. The classic case is a microservice architecture running on a monorepo. We have each service in a separate folder, and they are all decoupled, so there's no need to run the whole test suite for all microservices if we only change one microservice. This is where skipping tests makes most sense. The next point is using caching effectively. Downloading dependencies in our CI system each time we build or test can take a big chunk of our total time. We can use a cache to skip this part, to only reuse the downloaded dependencies and only invalidate the cache when something changes. The most obvious example is node modules, because it's a big directory, and downloading it and keeping it in sync, keeping all the modules downloaded and updated, takes a huge time and is CPU intensive and takes a lot of time in our CI system. We can save a lot of this time by stashing these node modules directly in a cache and then reusing it in all our builds. Another example of using a cache is with Docker. As you may know, a Docker image is composed by layers, and you have your base operating system image and then different layers with different packages. And if we organize our Docker file in a way that only the top layer change, we can reuse the lower layers, so that speed ups the build time tremendously. It's a matter just of organizing our Docker file and keeping a Docker image at hand, downloading it in our CI system, rebuilding with the cache enabled, and then uploading the new image to our registry. So this step is more involved and takes more effort, but it's worth your time, and it's fixing slow tests. These are tests that take too long to run, and you can identify them in your CI platform of choice. They usually have reports. In this case, we are seeing the average time for all the tests across all our workflows, and here we can sort our test by slowest first. So this is a good way to identify slow test. Your platform probably has some kind of report, and if not, you can always check the logs and check the duration of your jobs and actions to identify which test takes longer. Once you have identified these tests, you need to decide if you are going to fix them, delete them, quarantine them, or maybe run them on special occasions, like I said earlier. So we are reaching the end of our tips. The last one is to make our test more stable by eliminating flaky tests. A flaky test is a test that passes and fails randomly, and the main cause are usually timing condition or external dependencies. The problem with this test is that you can't trust them, and they send you on a wild goose chase trying to find the error when probably it's a false positive. You can identify this test by running your test suite continuously and identifying tests that seemingly randomly fail and pass. You can also use your CI platform reports if they have flaky test detection, and that makes identifying them a lot easier. If you are having problems with your pipeline, drop us a message and I will try to help you as much as I can. Thank you so much for watching. That's all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please leave us a like and subscribe. It helps us to keep making free content for everyone. Thank you so much for watching, and see you on the next one.